Good morning, everyone. Glad to see everybody here this morning. Hope you're enjoying the sunshine and the cool weather, because I guess we're supposed to have hot weather come back this week. So we'd like to welcome the Reverend Ken Faust and his wife this morning to do some preaching for us. So welcome, and we're happy to have you here at Union, both of you. As you can see in the church calendar, we have a lot of things going on. There will be a church picnic on September 8th, so there is a sign-up sheet in the back to bring a covered dish to share with everybody. The Church Life Committee will also provide the hot dogs and hamburgers and buns and all this stuff. If you could just please bring a dish to share and sign up for what you want to bring. Also, starting on September 8th, we will go back to the 11 o'clock worship service with Sunday school at 9:45. There will be a blessing of the pets on September 21st. And I think that's about it. Sue Jeffries has something for... Oh, also, too, if you have not picked up your new church directory, it's in the back, so make sure that you pick one of those up. Now, Sue Jeffries has an announcement about the soup sale.
Good morning. The mission team, the Redstone mission team, is scheduling their annual soup sale for September. If you look in your bulletin, you'll see an orders form, and we'll also get some more order forms out. The date of the sale is September 29th, but we're asked for the orders to be in on the 22nd. And you can see the types of the varieties we're offering, the same as in the past. And this will be to help support our trip to, we're going to go to Somersville, West Virginia in October. And I'll update you on the past trip, hopefully sometime this fall, get all that information together. The other thing is we want to keep the price of the soup sale the same for everyone. So we're asking if anyone wants to make donations for some of the canned items that we use in our soups. I have things here for like large cans of tomato juice, broth, those kinds of things. I'll put this in the back, and you can just sign your name and then just leave that in the back as well. We need that earlier, like by September 15th. It's on the form here, so that we can then shop for whatever items we need for making our soup that weekend. And also, I will put the soup order form envelope in the back. So once you have your order ready for soup, just put it in the envelope here. And if you have any questions, please let me know. You guys have always done a great job supporting our soup sale, so we appreciate that. Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. That was beautiful. Let's begin to worship through prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and holy God, we give you thanks. We thank you for this beautiful day that you've given to us today. We thank you for this gathering of our family and friends, brothers and sisters, united in common faith in Jesus Christ. We thank you for this gathering and gatherings like it around this area and around the world. Meet us here, God. Help us to encounter you in new and wondrous ways. We pray this in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen.
We have come to this place this morning to meet, worship, and praise our God and Lord. We gather here as God's people, called by God and redeemed by our Lord Jesus Christ. We celebrate God's great love for us, and we join with our brothers and sisters in faith in voicing our praises with unbridled gratitude and joy. The first hymn is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore You, number 13. Seated. Let's join together in the prayer of confession printed in your bulletin. Forgive us our sins of this day and every day, O God of grace and strength. We have sinned against you and our neighbors in thought, word, and deed, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you as you command, nor have we forgiven those who have wronged us. We do not live by faith and hope, nor do we trust you to provide what we need in our day-to-day existence. We are in need of your mercy, and we seek it in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Give us grace and strengthen us so that we may lead such lives as to make a difference in this grace-deficient world. Amen.
I have been with you before, and you know me to be somewhat long-winded. So if you remember nothing else about today's service, this is what I want you to remember. Ours is a God of love. God has loved us so much that he's given us the means of our redemption in the person and work of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grace has come to us because of Jesus, not because of us. And we accept it as the free gift that it is. Why? Because ours is a God of love. God loves you, and God forgives you through your faith in Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God for this marvelous, marvelous gift of grace. Friends, receive the good news. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation, and the old life has passed away. So be at peace and know that you are forgiven. Amen. Seated. As we prepare to hear God's word, let's do so in prayer. Let us pray. Holy God, we thank you for your word. We especially thank you for your living word, Jesus the Christ. As we hear these ancient texts read again for us here today, we ask that you would touch us by these words. Help us to see how profound they really are. Help us to understand the life that's contained in these words and words just like them. Help us to hear, help us to listen, help us to understand, and help us to live through Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Old Testament reading today is from Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, O Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. The New Testament reading is from the fourth book of Philippians, starting with the 10th verse. I rejoice greatly in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. I am not saying this because I am in need, for I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. This is the word of the Lord.
Pray with me, please. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts gathered here in this place this morning be pleasing in your sight. We offer this our prayer in the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. You are in for a wonderful treat this morning, because I am going to tell you one of the best stories that I tell. And because it's one of the best stories that I can tell, I have told it many, many, many times, but never part of a sermon. So as a result, I'm trying it out on you folks, okay? But did you notice I said I have told this story many, many times? Meaning my wife has heard this story many, many times. So if you look over at her in the middle of my story, and it's a long one, you look over at her and she is sleeping, just leave her alone, okay? But don't emulate her, please. Please don't do that. I don't know what you know about the state of Arkansas, or as some might call it, Arkansas. Arkansas is a wonderful state, as we found out over the past few years since our son Will and daughter-in-law Jada moved there. Arkansas is known as the natural state, and that's a pretty good moniker. Arkansas is beautiful. Now, parts of it are pretty flat and boring. But once you get into the Ozarks, you are encountering gorgeous, gorgeous territory. Will and Jada live in Russellville, Arkansas, which is towards the northwestern quadrant of the state. It's in the foothills of the Ozarks. In fact, here's a freebie, okay? I don't know if you get ARP magazine, AARP. ARP magazine, believe it or not, is the most widely circulated magazine in the world. Back in the spring, one of the articles had to do with places for retirees to live. Listed amongst the top 8 or 10 was Russellville, Arkansas. Unbelievable. We should live there, right, dear? Russellville is a marvelous little town. It's got a college, Arkansas Tech. Our son graduated from there last Christmas time with his master's in teaching. He's now a teacher in Russellville in the school district there. It has a certain ambiance about it. It appears to be an older town. The buildings, the architecture is wonderful. But there are a lot of young people running around, an awful lot of young people, our son and daughter-in-law's age. It's a lot of energy in Russellville. And one more thing about Russellville. Back in March or April, whenever the eclipse occurred, you remember that event? Well, Russellville was right smack dab in the middle of the path of totality. And as a result, when Barb and I were visiting Will and Jada a couple weeks before that event, we have to stay at a hotel because Barb has animal allergies and our kids have 7 dogs and cats. Not 7 dogs and 7 cats, but 7 animals, 4 and 3, as that goes. So we can't stay at their house very much. Otherwise, Barb can't breathe, and breathing is always good. Russellville's a wonderful place. Oh, I got off track, I'm sorry. I was gonna tell you that the hotel room we stayed in 2 weeks before totality, $89 a night, nice place, Comfort Inn. During that weekend of the eclipse, $589 a night. Yes! Oh, I can top that too. We were there, we took a hike on top of Mount Magazine, the highest point in the state of Arkansas. There in that state park, they have a wonderful lodge. We had lunch at the lodge after our hike. And I talked to the woman behind the counter. I said, what are you guys doing for the eclipse? And she said, oh, we've been planning for this for over a year. And I said, I'm not interested. We're not going to be here for the eclipse. So I'm not interested in making a reservation. But if I was, how much would that be? And she told me I would have to make a reservation for the entirety of the weekend for $2,000. Big business. We were there, Walmart was selling t-shirts saying, I survived the eclipse, you know, that sort of stuff. Anyways, enough of that. I'm making a long story even longer. Arkansas is a wonderful place. Many, many state parks, and amongst the state parks is this one. It's known as Petit Jean, okay? Petit Jean State Park. It's about 45 minutes from Russellville. Petit Jean, 2 words, French words. And if you've had French, you know the word for small, little is petite. Well, they pronounce it petty. And you know the word for John is Jean. Ooh, my French teacher will love that. Well, they pronounce it Jean. So it's Petit Jean. Now, let's not feel superior to the people of Arkansas because we call Versailles Versailles and Dubois should be Dubois. Yes. So we mix it up a little bit too. Anyways, I digress. Petit Jean. Petit Jean is there in the Ozarks. We drive there. We're surrounded by natural beauty. We go to the visitor center. I go up to the counter. There's a nice young man behind the counter. And I say to him, we are from Pennsylvania, near Pittsburgh. We might never be back to Petit Jean. Tell us what we must see before we leave this place. And we, meaning the 4 of us, but we, meaning this one over here and me, he could see us, okay? That's important for this story. He said, you must see Cedar Falls. We'd love to see Cedar Falls. He said, it is worth it. He said, it's a little bit of a hike, but it is well worth it at the end. Cedar Falls.
well, tell us, how do we see Cedar Falls? He said, you get in your car, you drive to the lodge. These state parks all have lodges. You drive to the lodge. You'll pick up the trailhead there. You follow the trail, it's well marked, and you will get to Cedar Falls. Great. We do that. We drive to the lodge. We go into the lodge, and the lodge is a beautiful place. There's a restaurant associated with it. They had up on their board the special of the day. You know what the special was? It was meatloaf. I could care less about meatloaf, but this one loves meatloaf. She loves meatloaf. So we decide, okay, we're going to do this hike. We're going to see Cedar Falls. We're going to come back here and have supper. And we're going to have a fine supper of meatloaf. Perfect day. Perfect day. We start down the trail. The trail had been developed by the CCC back during the days of the Depression. And we soon found out that the last time the trail had been maintained was by the CCC back in the Depression. This trail is in bad shape, ladies and gentlemen. Bad shape. In the middle of this trail are rocks that could only be described as huge boulders. You had to climb over these rocks in order to maintain the trail. It was very difficult doing that, okay? And the trail begins by you going down. And I wish I had a voice like James Earl Jones. So when I say the word down, it would sound like down. Down, down, down. It's a series of switchbacks through the forest, through the woods. Down, down, down. Climbing over boulders. Down, down, down. What lives in boulders? Snakes, looking for snakes. Down, 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 down. The trees were so thick we couldn't see how much farther we had to go before we got to level ground. It seemed like 20 miles. Down, down, down. We finally get down to the river, small river. We haven't seen the falls yet. The trail levels off and it follows this river for a while, which we do. And now we're encountering other people who are coming back. Okay? Now, one of the things you need to realize when you're on a hike and you encounter other people, they will lie, okay? They will lie. So when you ask them, is it much further? They will say, no, it's just up around the bend. That's what these people are doing to us. Is it much further? No, up around the bend. Is it worth it? That's why I'm asking. Is it worth it for us to get to Cedar Falls? And they would say, oh yes, it's beautiful. You can do this. You can do this. One of the things I noticed about these people coming the other way, in addition to their ease in lying to us, none of them, absolutely none of them, were our age. They were all Will and Jada's age. Okay? And this is starting to get through in my mind that maybe what's happened is this. This nice young man who was back there in the visitor center who sent us on this hike, maybe he wasn't so nice. Maybe what he really wanted to have happen was this. For us to get to the bottom of this gorge. And for the two of us then to require a helicopter rescue so they could practice. Yes, maybe that's what he was thinking. After a long time, we get to Cedar Falls. And it is beautiful, ladies and gentlemen. It is beautiful. It is gorgeous. Barb and I find a rock that probably was 400 or 500 yards away from the falls. We did not actually get to the falls and put our hand near the falls to feel the spray. We didn't do that. We collapsed on that rock. The other two went and they enjoyed time at the falls. There is a law of nature. It goes something like this: what goes down must come up. And now it's time for us to leave the falls and get back to the lodge, which means we have to retrace our steps, which means that, again, we have to crawl over boulders, which means, and this is the good part of it, which means then we too could lie to people who would come the other way about the distance. Oh, yeah, you've got it. You got this. It's just up there. Yes. Climbing back up over the rocks, the switchback, up and up and up and up. And we can't see where the end of this is because of the trees, but we keep going, knowing that we can do this. Maybe, perhaps we can. We finally drag ourselves to the top. To the top. We crawl over the top, and there is the lodge right ahead. We make ourselves get up and walk into the lodge. And what do we see? The blackboard was erased. They had run out of meatloaf, which meant I lied to my wife, because as we were crawling over rocks and she would be ready to give up, I'd say, "Meatloaf, meatloaf, meatloaf." None, none, none. We found something else to eat, and I went over to a display they had, and lo and behold, I found this brochure. It's called Petit Jean Trails Map, and it gives all the trails of the state park. And during dinner, I read out loud to my traveling companions about Cedar Falls Trail. And I want to read this to you, okay? First of all, it lists the length, the trailhead, the trail end, the trail blaze, and difficulty. Now, there are 8 trails through Petit Jean State Park. Two of them are listed as moderate to strenuous. The rest are moderate and easy, except for Cedar Falls Trail. Difficulty, strenuous. Strenuous. The first two sentences read as follows. The most popular hiking trail at Petit Jean descends again deep into Cedar Creek Canyon. Only those in good shape should attend this hike. Wear shoes or boots which provide ankle support and a firm grip. That young man, he could see me. He could see her. No one would ever say about Barb and Ken Faust, "Boy, they're in good shape, aren't they?" He knew this. He sent us there. Was it worth it? Yes. It was worth it for many reasons. One being, it was beautiful. And as we found out driving out of Petit Jean Park, there is a half-mile trail that is very easy. Most of it is set up as a boardwalk where you can get an overview of the falls. Oh, yes, yes, yes. We could have walked a half a mile on a nice boardwalk and seen the falls. If you go, I recommend that to you. I also got a good story out of it. I will do a lot of things for a good story. The third good thing about our hike that day was that we did it. We did it. We didn't die on the way. We didn't need to signal for a helicopter to get us out of there. We actually accomplished it. That was pretty good that day, wasn't it, dear? Teddy Jean. I can do everything through him who strengthens me. That's the last verse of Philippians chapter 4, the passage that Barb read for us today. That's an interesting verse because I think that verse gets taken out of context quite often. And as a result, it loses its real meaning. So for a few minutes here today, I want us to look at that verse in context. First, the overall, overarching context. Philippians was a letter. It was written by the Apostle Paul to the church at Philippi, a church near and dear to his heart. Paul writes this letter while in a Roman prison. Things are not going well for him, and they would get worse, dramatically worse, before everything ended. Paul has an inkling about all of this happening. He writes this letter, scholars call it the letter of joy, to the Philippians, as a means of encouraging them. That's the occasion of the letter. The more immediate context is this. Paul is telling the Philippians, thank you for thinking of me. Thank you for thinking of me. And he tells them, basically, I don't want you to be concerned about me. I don't want you to worry about me. I'm doing it. I am doing it. I'm okay. He said, I am content with life. If I'm in a Roman jail, I'm fine with it. He said, I've been in situations where I've had plenty. And I've been in situations of great need. And whether I've been in situations of plenty or great need, it didn't really matter. The circumstances didn't really matter because I would be content. I found the secret to contentment in life, and it has nothing to do with circumstances. It has everything to do with this. I can do everything through him who strengthens me. Now, let me argue with that verse for just a moment. I do not for one second believe that Paul is saying, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Because there are some things that I know I cannot and will not do. For instance, I will not be named the starting quarterback for the Steelers in 2 weeks. I will not win the presidential election in November. And I will not be able to leave this place today and start to flap my arms and magically fly from here to my house in Lower Borough in order to get home. Paul isn't saying, you can do these things. You can do these things. He's not saying that. Paul is not talking about that. What he's saying is this. I can deal with the circumstances of life just fine, relying not on me, certainly not on my strength, but I can do well. I can do fine. I can be content no matter how my life is because God is with me. I will never spend one nanosecond away from the presence of God, no matter where, no matter what. God is with me. God is with me. And God gives me the strength to deal with whatever I have to deal with in life. Always. Everywhere. No matter what. That's what Paul's saying here. He points to himself as the example, and he says, you can take that to the bank. Philippians, God is with you. 21st century followers of Jesus Christ, God is with you. Ooh, that's pretty good stuff. I have absolutely no idea of how your life is going. None. I don't know if today is a good day for you or if today is a lousy day for you. I don't know that. I don't know what you're facing. None of us knows what tomorrow will bring. But I can tell you this, and I can tell you this with absolute, positively, no doubt, certainty. God is with you. God is with you now. God is with you when you get in your car and leave. God is with you no matter where you go today. God is with you and will be with you tomorrow. If you're facing bad circumstances in life, God is with you. Don't misinterpret that. Don't say, oh no, I've been abandoned by God. I've been forsaken by God. I have sinned and I'm paying the consequence and God has left me. No, no, and no. God is with you no matter where, no matter what. Giving you, giving me, giving all people grace and strength sufficiently so that we can deal with it. I can do everything, says Paul, through him, through God, through Jesus Christ, who gives me strength. Thanks be to God. That is a wondrous, wondrous gift. Let's pray. Gracious God, we can do it. No matter what it is, we can do it. We can face today. We can face the problems of today. We can handle the pain of today. No matter what today is, you are with us and we are thankful. Remind us of this grace and continue to give us such grace to strengthen us for living our lives. Help us always, always, always to live for you. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Our hymn is number 315.
seated. I was handed a list that you filled out of folks to be in prayer for. Let me go down this list. And if I mispronounce a name, I do apologize. We need to be in prayer for Kenny, for Mary Jean, for Janet, for Jim, for Frank, for Nicole, for Larry, for Lisa, Lindsay, Leland, for Dave, Mark, it says here, thank you for prayer, successful liver transplant, that's marvelous. Chris, Mary Elizabeth, Monica, Miss T, Cindy and Tom, Mark Fogel, and Evelyn. I would offer my own. As out of shape as I am, my middle brother, Randy, is in great shape. He runs triathlons and marathons and has done so for many years. But as I told him in an email this week, I'm coming over to his place this week and challenge him to a race because on Thursday he had knee replacement surgery. Told him that's the only way I'm going to ever be able to beat him. So I would ask your prayers for him as he recovers from that surgery. It's gone very well for him. Are there other concerns or joys to be expressed as we come to prayer? Please. Marla. Please add Marla. That's fabulous, fabulous. Are you excited?
Yes.
Obviously. God's blessings. Tomorrow's going to be a great day for you. Others.
Phoenix and Morgan.
Pat.
College students at the school.
College students, yes, they are back, as well as secondary and primary students who have gone back or will go back this coming week. Yes, thank you. Others. And we should add teachers to that as well. Yes, yes, yes. Yeah, I'm sorry, dear. She's a retired teacher. She's giving me the stink eye there. Yes, yes. I didn't forget about you. I didn't. Others. Let's pray together. Gracious and holy God, we thank you. We thank you for this moment that we have to come to you in prayer. We thank you that you are there to hear us, not only by the words that we speak, but you know what's in our minds and our hearts. You touch us in so many ways. You strengthen us for all of life. You help us and you give us grace, grace beyond measure. We're thankful. We pray for all the folks who've been mentioned here today. We pray for those who are dealing with trouble, who are sick, maybe recovering from recent surgeries, transplants. We pray for those who have suffered loss and who grieve. We pray for those who are caught up in lives that are less than ideal. We pray for those who are living in homes or regions or nations of violence and oppression. We pray for those struggling with addiction. We pray for those who feel like they're all alone in this world. And for those who are living lives devoid of hope. We pray for all people everywhere who are in need, maybe of sustenance and shelter, but in need of you, and in need of the power and the strength and the grace that you give to people. Be with folks. Give healing, give comfort, give peace. We pray for this world we live in, God, and those who make decisions, leaders, not only here but around the world. We pray that they will seek your righteousness, your justice, and your peace. Gracious God, hear our prayer. We offer it in the mighty name of Jesus the Christ. And we pray now as he has taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. God has blessed us in so many ways. We return a portion of those blessings to God in tithes and offerings. We thank you, Father, for the blessings of this life. We pray that you would take and use our offerings for your purposes around the world. We pray this in the mighty and grace-filled name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. If memory serves me right, our last hymn is number 133. Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of us, now and forevermore. May we be granted peace. Amen.